internationally acclaimed composer Ryuichi Sakamoto will be playing for us live right here in the house. But first, in his time, our next guest has been a designer of bondage fashion, a filmmaker and even a rapper. But it says the architect of punk rock that he's probably best known, with a bid to become London's first elected mayor, with a maverick manifesto which would be enough to make Red Ken go green. Never mind the ballots, here he is, Malcolm Mclaren. You know, Malcolm, I can hear them all saying, you cannot be serious. I mean, are you really, really serious about this?
I think when I was first approached, I suppose, by the New Statesman magazine to write a voice of dissent about what was becoming somewhat of a pantomime, I probably added to it in some way. And as time has gone on, I'm still here. I'm doing what I was originally press-ganged into, I think, by journalists wanting me to create some havoc in what seemed to be a big farce.
So is this, in a way, much to your surprise?
It's much to my surprise that I'm still here battling away as an independent voice. And as time goes on, in an organic manner, I sort of become somewhat more articulate about my thoughts. And it, maybe it's because I'm a Londoner, I guess, that I can have humour and I can raise issues that otherwise political parties and those that represent them can't. And suddenly I find myself becoming, dare I say it, serious.
But believing simply, your own manifesto?
Well, simply because, yes, and simply because the amount of response I've had, not just from Londoners themselves, but also like-minded people living in Liverpool or Glasgow or even as far away as Paris.
Now, you allegedly can't stand politicians anyway, so if you were to be elected as mayor, how would you ever begin to work with the Labour government?
Well, I think, you know, sometimes it's better the devil you know than the devil you don't know. And I think that, without a shadow of a doubt, I've just treated the whole mayoral role as a position in which it's supposed to be someone, I think, who protects London and Londoners from government, not someone who sleeps with them. So I kind of feel that it's a form of devolution, not unlike what happened recently in Scotland or Wales. It's about people trying to control their own destinies a little more.
I know, but you're a wild
it's
man
a
by reputation,
idea,
though,
it?
Malcolm. And are you tamed enough to be the mayor of London?
Oh, you know, I have the heart of a child. I have the innocence, unquestionably, of a cultural creature that constantly taps into the zeitgeist. I'm not someone who basically is a manipulator, as most people think. I'm not someone who also has not actually done something for this town. I am a fourth-generation Londoner.
So what would you do then if you got the power? Because apparently this mayor will have powers, unlike some of the previous roles.
Difficult to know with this new Labour Party. I think they kind of move the goalposts as they see fit.
All right, dream list. What would you do with London?
Well, one thing London sorely needs is a better transport system, and it sorely needs somebody. Not necessarily me. I think the mayor stands as a figurehead. What the mayor needs to have, he or she or whoever, is a genuine cabinet of talents, people who are not particularly allied to one political party or another, but people who are just very, very good at the job.
So what would you do for transport?
Well, it's not what I would do personally, but what I've gleaned from others who perhaps have been studying transport for many, many years. They realise one clear thing, and that is you need a real long-term agenda to improve London. The problem with politicians and parties is they are often in power for a limited period of time, so therefore their agendas are always inevitably going to be short-term. So you need a long-term agenda, and you need some independent body who, in essence, work for Londoners, work for people who use a transport. I think in some ways, Londoners have to, in the end, own the transport system in some shape or form. Yeah, I think they need to issue bonds in some way. They need to have almost a non-profit organisation. There's no point in looking at London transport system as something that should make a profit. It's there as a service for everyone, and it should be subsidised, and it should be ultimately controlled by Londoners, and therefore never, ever to be taken out of their hands without some general form of consensus.
What else is in your manifesto? What's some of the bizarre end of it?
Well, bizarre ends. I think culturally, the most important thing that I could do is to act as an ambassador in that regard, particularly in the world of fashion and retail, particularly in the world of music, particularly in looking at what is a real multicultural, diverse community. For all intents and purposes, if you look at these politicians, you still think it's an Anglo-Saxon city. It isn't. There are people from all over the world that live here. And I don't think they're necessarily represented culturally, not in a real way. I'd like to see a multi sort of cultural musical flag appearing in London.
But you wouldn't have, like, a revival of the Pistols, would you?
No, but if you were a blind man, for instance, you know, and you're walking through London, how do you know where you are, really? It'd be nice to know where you are if you heard the sound of that place. It sounds a bit odd, but I think it really could work. I think what London's great at is being able to culturally put things together that make up what is a unique flavour. We're known and watched by the world for our ideas. We're known to be able to move the culture forward.
Well, and certainly you did that in your time. You certainly moved culture forward in terms of all the fashions and everything. But how have your associates and friends reacted to this idea of you standing as mayor?
Well, surprisingly enough, they actually greeted it with a lot of enthusiasm. And I, in turn, had to sort of suddenly look at myself and think, gee, I really need a brilliant team. I really need a brilliant team to be able to help.
So who would you have on your
platform.
Team?
Well, I looked at people who, for instance, I felt, in terms of direct action that had done something genuine for the community, were people, for instance, who run the big issue. I felt that they had decriminalised certain things, certain elements, people. I felt they had helped the socially excluded and the disenfranchised, and they are, without a shadow of a doubt, people who represent a true voice of London. So definitely you'd want to bring them on board to help you deal with those specific issues, those specific problems.
Malcolm, I'm going to have to leave it at that.